Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Paradigm of absolute control.
We got him, ladies and gentlemen. It's Dylan Raiola Day on the Common Fan Podcast. Heck, it's Dylan Raiola Week. It's Dylan Raiola Month. It is the Dylan Raiola Era. Today is Tuesday, December 19th, year of our Lord, 2023. And less than 24 hours ago, Dylan Raiola, the top high school quarterback recruit in these United States, committed to play for the Nebraska Cornhuskers football team. This is a real thing that happened, people. We cannot wait to get into what this means for the Huskers going into 2024 and beyond with a very special guest today. I'm TJ Burkle. With me, as always, are Maddie Owens Sr. and Geoff in Lincoln. Make sure to check out the Common Fan Podcast's new YouTube channel at youtube.com/@commonfangbr. And hit that subscribe button when you do. And if you watch this episode on YouTube, you can see our smiles from ear to ear about the big Dylan Raiola news. You can also follow the podcast on your streaming platform of choice. Follow us on Twitter at @commonfangbr. Email us at commonfangbr@gmail.com. And of course, check us out on Facebook and Instagram. We are joined today by Zack Carpenter, who, of course, is the publisher of Inside Nebraska, which can be found at nebraska.rivals.com. The Inside Nebraska team brings you all the latest in Nebraska football, basketball, and other Husker sports, and, of course, all the recruiting news. You should also make sure the Inside Nebraska podcast is part of your regular rotation to help you feed the addiction to all things Huskers. Zack, thank you so much for joining the Common Fans on what is a massive week for Husker football.
Yeah, I mean, TJ, thanks for having me on. Matthew, Geoff, I appreciate you guys having me on. And I mean, that intro music, I like to think that you guys are talking about me with the, we got him on. But, no, it's
exactly. It's exactly what it was for.
Big day for the podcast. Yeah,
exactly. Happy Dylan Day to all those who celebrate. It's been a whirlwind. I mean, it's still, I think every Husker fan should have had a stiff drink or five last night to celebrate, because that's how big this this recruiting win is. And it's been a crazy journey because, as you guys know, I followed him. I was at Ohio State covering mainly recruiting, and so I've been following since the first time he popped on the scene and became an Ohio State, the priority target there, all the way from around January 2022 is December 21, January 22, when he sort of popped on the radar there, all the way up to now. And it feels like even longer than just a 2 year period through everything that's happened here.
No doubt. Well, let's get right to it. Zack, I read your entire 3-part analysis of Dylan Raiola, which all Common Fans should check out if you haven't already. Safe to say you are very high on Mr. Raiola. You compare him to Patrick Mahomes. You referenced that Lincoln Riley thought Raiola was the top quarterback across the last couple of recruiting classes. And to go even further, if I may quote you, you say, quote, "The Huskers have a guy at quarterback whose ceiling is as high as you can go in the sport. Heisman winner, number one overall pick in the NFL draft, franchise quarterback, NFL superstar, MVP, Super Bowl winner," end quote. I also like that was in part one of the analysis. Goodness. I liked that you started part two by saying you don't really care if people thought that was too much. I really appreciated you standing by your words there. That's some pretty high praise for an 18-year-old kid who has yet to take a snap as a college football quarterback. What makes you so high on him?
Yeah, I mean, I stand by what I said, that those are the markers that he could hit. Those are the achievements possible for him if he continues to do what I know he has done his whole life and football career, is work hard and study the game and be coachable and progress and develop. And that's why this recruitment took such a long journey, is because there's a lot riding on his decision. And I couldn't be higher on him because of everything that he brings to the table physically, everything he has mentally. I mean, you look at him, he has the 6'3", 220 to 230 frame, unbelievably strong arm. I mean, you watch some of his highlights and he's just whipping 55 yard passes, air yard passes, like on a dime off of 1 foot while getting tackled accurately into receivers in stride. And he avoids pressure. He has a feel for the game. He can throw from all the arm angles. That's a lot of the main Patrick Mahomes comparison comes from, the way he's able to just fling it sidearm, submarine, if you want, like launch it downfield. And the manipulation of the pocket that you see with Tom Brady and Mahomes that he has. And all of that, though, with Mahomes, it's the superpower that not a lot of people talk about, or at least didn't at the beginning of his career, is his brain. Like, that's what everybody within the Chiefs organization says about Mahomes, is like, he has a photographic memory, and it's his ability to recall information and be able to read defenses pre-snap and see things once and boom, it's there. And Mahomes is also a student of the game, and Raiola is built a lot of the same way, and he has a photographic memory as well. Like, when he got he went from Burleson to Chandler High School, and when he got there, he was recalling plays. His offensive coordinator at Chandler asked him, like, hey, what plays do you want? He wanted him to bring the top 10 plays of his favorite things he's run at Burleson, and he brought them, and he was able to recall the exact protections for every offensive lineman on every play and the intricacies that he knew, and he continues to study the game. So he has the NFL bloodlines. He has so many resources in his back pocket, and he knows. And that's the thing. His mentality, his even keeled, never too high, never too low. You can see it play out on the field, but that's the other thing where I feel like when you look at Nebraska, after everything we saw last year with the quarterback situation, especially Jeff Sims, I don't think it's been more glaringly clear that the most important trait you can have as a quarterback, especially here in the fishbowl that is Nebraska football, is to be mentally strong, have that willpower to be even keeled. If things are going great and you're leading them to a 5-0 start, just trust the process, stay calm, stay composed. And if you're going 0-5, same deal. And they have a head coach who has that mentality now. And Dylan is a lot the same way, which is, I think, why one big reason why this sort of marriage between a generational talent at quarterback and a head coach who needed a really good quarterback and got the best one that he could have gotten in Raiola. And I know all of those things are the Heisman winner, MVP, obviously, like you said, a lot of pressure and expectations to throw on a kid. But I don't feel like I'm overstepping, because those are the goals he has. Those things that I said in that story, to be able to one day be shedding tears while saying a speech in Canton at an NFL Hall of Fame induction ceremony, those are the goals. It's not like I'm out of bounds in assessing it like that, because those are the goals that he's been working for a long time. And that's, again, why this process took so long, because you're trying to find the perfect spot and the infrastructure in place. Because despite what everybody says with all the transferring of high schools and whatnot, which I don't see as nearly a big deal as a lot of people do, you don't want to transfer at the college level. You want to find the place that's right for you and be there your whole career. Even if the transfer portal now allows you to, you'd rather avoid that if possible. So again, I know I'm rambling, but I have a lot of thoughts, and I'm very passionate about it, because he is so fun to watch, and the ceiling for him is sky high, and Nebraska's ceiling as a program just goes to another level with him in it.
Ramble away, Zach. It's beautiful.
Yep. I was going to say, if I'm praising, it's the most important recruit. And since Tommy Frazier, I think arguably the most important. I mean, depends on at the time of his signing anyway. Tommy Frazier is the best quarterback in Nebraska history. And I don't think that I don't know if he could ever be unseated, but the fact that how important this win is deserves all of a three-part analysis story. And we have like 8 stories up right now on our front page. It's all Raiola content, and there are reasons why.
Zach, well, you mentioned Tommy Frazier, and we've had some pretty highly touted recruits over the years. It's been a while, but none as highly rated as Raiola. What do you think? What pieces need to be in place around Dylan to give him the best chance of succeeding at Nebraska?
Yeah, I mean, well, you start off with the head coach and the alignment. I mean, the alignment that is here with the athletic director and Matt Rhule, and then trickles down to the players. So everybody's a part of the same process of all moving in the same direction. And I thought you saw, even in the midst of that 4-game losing streak to end the season, I felt like it was still all moving in the same direction. And they lost because of continued turnover. The number one reason they lost is because of the turnovers, but they didn't have dissension. People weren't breaking apart. And I think that really, really matters. But the next piece of it is quarterback development. That was a huge reason why he picked Georgia after decommitting from Ohio State, was because they had an unbelievable infrastructure in place to develop quarterbacks. And I mean, they hired Dylan's main recruiter, primary recruiter at Clemson, who was the quarterbacks coach. He might have been the OC, Brandon Streeter, but he left Clemson to be an analyst at Georgia. It's like you have one of the top guys at Clemson going to Georgia to be like the second or third guy in that hierarchy in regard to quarterback development. It's a big deal. So I think we're looking at a similar situation, I think, at Nebraska. I mean, I know for a fact there's going to be a change or changes to the offensive staff as far as quarterback development goes. I do not know specifics as of now. Like, I don't know.
Would you like to break some news on the Common Fan podcast?
Well, I was saying this on the Insiders board last night at InsideNebraska.com. Great site, great board. Check it out. But I said that last night. I know that a change is coming, but I don't know specifics. I don't know who it is or who they are. I don't know the role or titles. Like, I don't know if it's going to be a co-OC or a full-time quarterbacks coach. They're just bringing in a quarterback analyst. I'm not sure, but I know a change is coming. And I think that's, again, I keep using the word primary, but it's a primary reason that one of them, that Dylan wound up looking at Nebraska again and ultimately committing, because he knows, he's confident in what's going to be, what the infrastructure is going to be in terms of his development. So, I don't think we can overlook that part of it at all, but that's from a coaching perspective. And then you have Donnie Raiola, who will be there. You cannot have a better guide, in my opinion, to have with Dylan. He's very close with his uncle. So with all the pitfalls that are like pressures and whatnot that come with being the quarterback at Nebraska, I mean, again, he has the right mentality for it, but I also think he has a really good guide in place.
Zach, you just mentioned Uncle Donnie Raiola, and I was curious about this. I thought you would probably know if anybody. I kept seeing in stories that the kind of the recruiting contact rules don't apply to him. Is it because he's family? For three common fans who aren't able to follow recruiting as closely as we would like, you know, with kids and all that other stuff, with things we have going on, we can't follow this as well as we'd want. But I kept reading that those rules don't apply to him. Could you explain that a little bit?
Yeah, I'm not, I don't brush up on the rule book probably as much as I should. I mean, I've, I use, there's a board member, Sugarland, Texas, on our site who, like, I'll always, not always, but I've messaged a few times before, like, hey, am I right on this rule? And then he explains it, like, in detail, like, okay, yeah, I would have never known that. He links me to the rules pages. I'm like, so it's section 15, article B, Roman numeral 8.
And bylaw, like, 12.
Bylaw, yeah, I don't, yeah, like, make up a number. I'm like, I swear, did they just put this in, like, yesterday? Because I did not know this. So I don't know specifics of the rule. That's my understanding as well, though, that because he's a family member, that he, the rules don't apply as strictly to him. And I know that means, like, I mean, Dylan's visited a billion times to Lincoln, and a lot of times it's been a family reunion, or he's coming up to see Donnie, or his brother Dayton is coming up because he's a Nebraska recruit as well. So then he tags along, and I mean, you see Donnie was like his, wouldn't say tour guide or chaperone, but kind of the chaperone during his official visit this past weekend. Mm-hmm. You saw him with him all over the place. So that's what sort of set in, like, when I saw that, it sort of, that's when it, like, actually set in, like, oh yeah, Donnie is going to be here. If Dylan's here, and that's going to be, I mean, Donnie Raiola is as headstrong and also even keeled as they come. So I don't think you have a better guide in place. And that's from the coaching sample. I also think Greg Smith and Steve Marek are a couple of our staff writers at Inside Nebraska. They, I listened to their breakdown. Like, they had pre-record a video in anticipation of Dylan committing, and they made a lot of really good points that I hadn't thought of, with the infrastructure of the offensive line, with all those veteran guys coming back, and Rule challenging those juniors and seniors, like, hey, we got a kid coming in here to be our quarterback. I mean, in my eyes, I'm viewing it as Dylan Raiola is going to be the starting quarterback. He still has to win the job and compete, but I don't see a world in which he's not the starter for Nebraska in 2024 and you would think beyond. But we got a kid coming in here, like, I am trusting you guys to protect him. He's the future of our offense, future of our program, like, college football franchise quarterback, essentially. And you have, hopefully you can bring in a receiver, a veteran out of the portal, but you have good young talent in that room, and we'll wait to see what happens at running back. But then on the other side, you have everything that Tony White and that defense brings back. So there are good parameters in place, and I think they're going to be able to bring him along at his own pace, not at his own pace, but not come in and expect him to have to throw for 4,000 yards and win the Heisman in year one. So they, yeah, like, all of those things that we said at the beginning are true, in my opinion. Those are the ceilings, or that's the ceiling of what he can accomplish, but it's not just going to, I don't think it's going to happen right away. There are going to be some growing pains. It's going to be hard for him, but I think he has the mentality to weather those difficulties, be coachable and develop here. And eventually we'll see that ceiling matched one day in Lincoln.
Love it. Can't wait. Looking forward to it. Well, you know the history of the program, and we've kind of had a rough stretch as Nebraska Cornhusker fans, 7 consecutive losing seasons. I haven't been to a bowl game since 2016. Our egos are a little damaged now. We're a little bit more fragile as a fan base. So it's great that this news came, because it does give us that light at the end of the tunnel, so to speak, that glimmer of hope, something that we've all been yearning for years and years. Just how big of an accomplishment or a W is this for Matt Rule and the Huskers, more of like a big picture look at things?
Yeah, I mean, and you guys come by that honestly, that mindset. I mean, with everything that's gone wrong, it's like, all right, what can go wrong now? And you see, I don't know if it's the pinnacle of that, but you saw it, the latest example of that with how the year ended, starting off 5-3 and finishing 5-7. It's like, you're one away. Yep. And the way you lost those games is just agonizing. Like, so I get it. And I think Matt Rhule throughout the year, Greg Smith and I talked about this. It's like he's still paying for the sins of the past that weren't his fault. With some of the decisions that he made, they would be questioned like to the utmost degree because there's been some burned souls around here. Like there's been hesitancy because of how many times that you trust in something and then it doesn't wind up being coming to fruition or being true. And I mean, I equate a lot of things that I covered of relationships, whether it's recruiting or football, like feels like Nebraska fan base is the person who got cheated on or like had a disloyal partner over and over, but then you kept excusing it away. Like,
yeah, keep coming
no,
back.
No, he's going to be different. Like it's going to change or she's going to be,
but I love him
loyal this time. Like, yeah, like I love him. Like I can't let go. And then you just keep welcoming back the disloyal person, keep welcoming back and excusing it away, even though you know in your heart that they're going to let you down. Yeah. And they're going to be disloyal again, but whatever, we're just going to keep it going. We're going to ramp it back up. Or it's the family member. Nebraska is a family member who has another family member who keep letting you down. You know they're going to again, but they're family, so you can't let go. You can't just give up. And that's why I think, I mean, with everything that's been in place since Rhule got here, the things he said as introductory press conference, he's followed through on so many things. And I just kept looking back, like throughout the year, he would say something or we would see it happen. And he would show us what he was talking about in the beginning. Like when the best example is he said, we will leave no stone unturned to find talent here. Like we're going to take the walk-on program seriously. We're going to recruit in state. We're going to look everywhere. And then what you see, like former walk-on guys earn scholarships and become starters, three or four. And so that's the great sign in terms of that. But then when you look big picture now with a five-star quarterback, ultimate talent like Raiola, it's just like the big picture with what he can bring to the table himself and with what he can bring as far as other talents, because his Rolodex is as long as you can get with five stars and four stars. So who knows what happens down the road, but you should be excited even for the most jaded of Husker fans.
That's awesome, Zach. And I want to go back to something you mentioned a minute ago, but kind of looking ahead to the quarterback situation in 2024. So as of right now, as of today, at least, you've got two guys on the roster who have started games as Nebraska's quarterback, right? Heinrich Harburg and Chuba Purdy. And then, of course, in 2024, both, you know, Dylan Raiola and Danny Kalen out of Bellevue West, also an excellent high school quarterback, an elite 11 guy, right? Looks like he's sticking with his commitment and he's coming to Nebraska as well. So both of those guys enter the picture in 2024. You know, I kind of just curious, a lot of questions around this, right? So because the transfer, you know, signing day is tomorrow, but as far as transfers go, that sort of never stops. They could add a guy in January. They could add a guy after spring ball. So do the Huskers keep looking around for a more senior guy like a Kyle McCord type player? And also, you know, kind of curious if you have any insight as to whether, you know, Purdy or Harburg, are they looking around? Because, you know, look, I think we're all excited about the Raiola news. We're all ready to hand him the Heisman here in Husker Nation. Don't get me wrong. But the kid's 18 years old. Like that's a lot to put on him. You know, you got to assume there will be growing pains no matter how good he ends up being. So kind of how do you see that play? And you just said, though, you think he's going to be the starter. And let's say he's great right out of the chute. You know, when was the last time we had a season without a quarterback missing a couple games due to injury? Right. I mean, there's all kinds of reasons why you need more than one functional quarterback in 2024 in the Big Ten. So kind of how do you see that playing out? What do you see that room looking like maybe post spring game or going into the fall?
Yeah, I agree. I don't anticipate either Purdy or Harburg leaving, but I mean, there's, I don't think there's anything that would surprise me in today's transfer portal era, unless right. it was like Caleb Williams decides not to enter the draft and transfer somewhere. Like, that's like the only thing I think that would be truly shocking in this day and age. So like we say in recruiting, never say never in recruiting, never say never in the portal. But I don't anticipate them adding a veteran guy. I think if they keep what they have in place, then I think that's the quarterback room we're looking at. And if you have Chubba Purdy and Heinrich Harburg, two very experienced guys now, after last season, Purdy, obviously not as much as Harburg, with less games, but you now have playing experience in the Big Ten and in the big moments. And Chubba looked really good against Wisconsin. He was obviously struggled against Iowa, and then you have the three picks to end three games in a row. But I trusted him to be a high quality backup if he chooses not to look elsewhere. But I believe he graduated this past weekend, so. He is a grad. He would be a grad transfer, so you could go anywhere. And also, there's the new, new bylaw or whatever is in place the new court order, the temporary restraining order, that was put in place to allow anybody to transfer, whether no matter what your status is in college, whether you're grad transfer, underclassman, up till I think the December 27th, I think was the date. It was a 2-week period. I might be getting the dates wrong, but. I think he could look elsewhere, but I do think at this point I would expect both of them to stay. So if you're looking at that room with a couple experienced backups like that, and then you get to develop Danny Kalen on the back end of it, like you said, they have two Elite 11 quarterbacks coming into the room. That's a fact that I broke the news that Danny Kalen was planning on staying committed to Nebraska, and I didn't even think about that fact until one of our board posters pointed it out last night that Nebraska now has two Elite 11 quarterbacks. I was like, oh yeah, they both did go out there. Forgot about that. That's pretty wild. Like, who would have thought? Like the Paul Rudd meme.
Yeah. Not me.
So you can't be mad about that. You can't be like, I think they're. Their quarterback situation, I think, is lining up to look much better than this last season. And I had anticipated them adding a portal quarterback, a high quality transfer, or the best they could get on the market. And then it looked like that was happening with Kyle McCord. And then boom, get wind of last Monday the 11th. And it's like, oh, this thing looks like it could be happening. And it's one of the crazier, more high octane weeks of recruiting I've ever covered. So it'd be fun.
So Zach, there's been a little bit of smoke about Casey Thompson returning for a seventh year of college football. You haven't really heard any smoke on that. I keep seeing stuff about that on Twitter.
I've seen all the rumors and reports, and I haven't said anything about it because I've gotten different answers on it about it could be a possibility or no, it's definitely not. So when I'm getting conflicting information like that, and then like I don't have it completely locked down, I don't feel confident saying one way or the other. So sure. But I think that adding on top of the entire last week, it's like you start catching wind of Casey Thompson might be coming back. It's like what? I mean, I would love that. If they bring Casey Thompson back, I don't know if there's going to be at least a reporter on the beat more excited than me, because I loved Casey Thompson during his 1 year here. I mean, he wasn't a Heisman finalist or anything, but he brought stability to that room. And I thought I got annoying last year when I kept saying, I probably wrote it 6 or 7 times, like, Casey Thompson's the third best or fourth best quarterback in this conference. I mean, he's not CJ Stroud or JJ McCarthy, but he's up there. Like, Aiden O'Connell's probably would rank above him, but he's in that upper tier. And I mean, I thought what he brought in terms of toughness, getting just absolutely demolished on a weekly basis, because of the offensive system and the pass pro that was set up, which I don't think was all on the offensive line by any means. But I would be extremely excited. I thought I thought that him transferring out and the way that situation was handled wasn't from the people I spoke with. I didn't think that was the right decision. I understood the decision. I fully understood what happened. I just disagreed with it. So
sure.
And I think we saw it play out that, I mean, if Casey Thompson was here last season, then you have more stability. Maybe he gets hurt. Who knows? And maybe we shouldn't like hash that all that out, like of what could have happened. But if he comes back, that would be, I think that would be the exact type of deal. Like if Husker fans are getting excited about that one too, I think you should be, because he brings that stability as well.
Yeah, good guy to have in the quarterback room.
Definitely. Well, that being said, Zach, the one thing I think we're all curious about is, and I listen to some other sports talk radio shows, and the common consensus I've heard from a lot of hosts is if and when Dylan was going to commit to Nebraska, others will follow. So we're pretty excited, obviously, about what he's capable of on the field. But I wanted to get your thoughts on what could be possible off the field. You've got people sending out cryptic tweets and the staff saying we're not done yet. And so that gives you hope that maybe – are there any surprises heading our way that we don't know about for National Signing Day tomorrow? Any dominoes that are going to fall or any ripple effects just from his commitment? Anything else you think you've got on the radar for us?
Yeah, I mean, it's a little more difficult than it was because of the way the numbers situation is. Like, I mean, last year they clearly weren't worried about it. They brought in 11 new transfer portal additions. I think it's 13 if you count Xavier Betts and Isaiah Garcia Castaneda coming back, and then 28 high school signees. So a little different situation last year, and this year I think the transfer portal market for them will be going a lot more realistically of what they want of supplementing through the portal. And I don't think we've heard Rule talk about it, and hasn't said this exactly, but he's going to sign guys. Like, I think his approach is more like sign them and ask questions later, like as far as the numbers situations go. Yeah, you can't get too many offensive linemen, can't get too many defensive linemen. And there's different things with the NIL and that you can get a little more creative with things. I don't think that I do think we're in for some surprises, maybe a couple late flips here. There's a couple four-star linebackers who visited this past weekend and alongside with Raiola, and Dylan Williams committed to Oregon, and Vincent Shavers committed to Miami, and then there's Larry Tarver Jr. I believe those are Larry Tarver Jr. Yeah, that's the only one I was unsure of. But I don't think we're going to see, like, it's not going to be the same bump that you might get if Dylan had committed back in June or July. Mm-hmm. But if you're a Nebraska fan, I think you take that. I think you take that in a heartbeat of, okay, absolutely. Yeah, Dylan committed 2 days before signing day. Like, okay, we don't have to keep recruiting him for 6 or 7 months. Like, we know he's going to be here. We know he's going to sign, instead of a 6 month, all right, well, Ohio State, but Georgia mainly, like, they're going to keep recruiting him. They could wind up flipping him. So you lose that bump and in the immediacy, but in the 25 class, you could be looking at some higher level prospects coming in when they see how things are rolling here on both sides of the ball. But I do think we could be in for a couple of surprises, like you said, on signing day Wednesday.
That'll be fun.
Excellent. Love it.
Well, we're currently, Nebraska is sitting at 21, ranked 21st in Rivals national team recruiting rankings. Do you see foresee any movement either one way or the other by the time the dust settles tomorrow and signing day, moving up a little bit or moving down?
Yeah, I mean, we saw a couple decommitments, and it was funny that a month ago, Greg and I were walking out of a press conference after recording one of our post-presser videos, and it's just like, was like, so like we're talking about, all right, who is going to be hardest to hang on to in this class? Because we were like, I mean, just it's a big boy business. It's college football. We know for a fact, we both had been covering recruiting wilds. Like there's going to be decommitments, happens every year.
Right.
No matter what the situation or the factors are. And we were like, I think Kawan Lacey is one to watch. Carlin Jones is one to watch. We talked about a couple others that's going to be hard to keep in the class. And then those two guys decommit and go elsewhere. And I'm obviously not going to say specific names, but I guess I wouldn't be totally shocked if there's another decommitment, just because that's the nature of how it goes with being in the recruiting game long enough that you see it happen all the time. So, but those guys I mentioned earlier, I think with Shavers and probably Tarver, those are two guys to be looking at in the high school ranks. And Bly Hill, the corner from St. Francis out there in PA. He's a Maryland high school guy. He's a corner who, with all the Raiola stuff and McCord, that situation going, you flew completely under the radar that he was that he scheduled an official visit, and then he wound up taking it to Nebraska. And I've been told that earlier on in the day on Monday, but then all of the quarterback stuff completely overshadowed it, that like, hey, there's a guy to be on the lookout for. So now all that dust has settled, I think he's a guy that you can focus up a little more on, learn background on if you're a Husker fan, like, because I think he's a corner, and I think corner is a spot that you can add help out of the portal this off season with losing Quentin Newsom. You want to add some strength there. So those are just a few of the guys to watch.
Awesome.
Awesome. Well, Zach, we want to be mindful of your time. I know it's super, probably one of the busiest weeks of the year for you. I've got one final question, if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
I know you're not a native Nebraska guy. You moved and took over as a Rivals publisher, what, about a year and a half ago? So I'm curious,
June 22.
Know, how much, if you've had a chance to check out, and if you have a favorite among some of the local favorites, Runza, Amigos, Valentino's, any other local spots that maybe I didn't mention that are among your favorites?
Yeah, so my first, I came out here in June 22 for like 10 days, and I immediately tried Runza because I'm like, I've heard so much about it, and was told what to order, and it was awful. And I looked back at the text. No, don't get too excited, Jeff.
Damn it.
I look back at the text from what was recommended to me. I'm like, gosh, I ordered it wrong. I ordered the wrong thing. Then I ordered.
What did you get?
It was a Southwest thing that like had like onions and like some I don't know. It's just I like spicy food, but like it just wasn't good. And then I'm like, all right, wait a few days. Wait a few days, milk it again. Yeah, exactly. Like cleanse the soul, cleanse the body.
Right.
I went back and got the right thing a few days later. I'm like, still don't love it, but it's not bad. Like it's not bad. It's not man, the level the first order was.
How can you not like a lukewarm
you
cabbage
stop it,
hot pot?
Stop it, Jeff.
How can you not love that?
I was gonna say I heard Nebraskans are very, very protective of it, or think the exact opposite. Like,
well, most of us are protective, but Jeff for some reason is anti Nebraska, anti-American,
communist.
Yeah.
We also talk a lot, for some reason, I think this started with Jeff too, but we started to talk a lot on this program about the Jeff Sims combo at Amigos. Mm-hmm. And wondering like who will take that over in 2024, like which player, and then will it be the same food items, or will they change the food items at all? But I think Jeff,
what's the Jeff Sims combo?
What, Geoff, you want to take that one?
Well, we were cutting out there for a second, but if we're just talking about the Jeff Sims combo, it's delicious. It's a secret menu item. You can still get it, Zach. If
really?
You be on the board, just say, hey, I'll take the Jeff Sims combo meal, and they'll give it to you at $8.99. It's delicious.
And what is it, Jeff? Yeah. Exactly.
Soft shell taco, crisp meat burrito, Mexi fries, and a medium drink. I would definitely say you need to pair some cheese sauce and some ranch with that. They do charge extra, however, just so you know that.
All right. Well, I am going to, I mean, I'm going to have this podcast download, so I'll skip ahead to this part and then write it down in the notes.
Perfect.
App
because there you go.
I have a notes app with Lincoln and Omaha recommendations. And my girlfriend moved from Columbus in July, this past July, moved from Columbus, Ohio to here. And I was like, all right, I'm putting together a list of everything I can for recommendations and things. So like, so I have a blueprint of restaurants, bars, like salons, gyms, tattoo parlors. I'm like, hey, maybe we'll do this for some reason down the road. So I have a bunch of recommendations on there. I've been to Valentino's. Yeah. It's
a little overpriced
to post press at the press conferences. I don't know what you guys think. Yeah. But my two favorite pizza places I've had in order, and I think I've only had five or six pizza spots here, but Momo's would be number one.
Oh, yeah.
Nice. There you go.
Those are the top two. I don't know if that's crazy to say. I have
I would agree with that.
No clue.
But Momo's is good, man. I agree.
Yeah.
What do you have at number two?
Yes.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yes. Yeah,
staple.
It's good too.
Yes.
Yeah, it's on DoorDash too. So it'll be here. Like every time I order, it's like, all right, I know what I'm getting. Just order that. Yep. And I know that I'm gonna be happy with that one. That those two places, Muchachos, have been there a few times. I love Muchachos. Got good tacos and margaritas. That's always a good happy hour deal. So there's so much though. There's so like I said, my girlfriend moved here July, so only a few months ago, and I've been here for over a year and a half, and she's already explored more than me. So I'll leave the computer in the office for a long time. I need to explore a little more.
Can we get you on record as saying Lincoln is better than Columbus?
No. I really like. So that's the thing. I really like Lincoln. I loved Columbus, but the difference to me, not the difference. It's just I experienced the city more in Columbus because. Like I had a different job there. Like now it's, the job didn't have as many demands as this one where I feel like I'm working a lot more because of the position and stuff calls for it. So I haven't explored Lincoln nearly as much, as I want to, or as I will be, come probably spring, summer, despite how long I've lived here. But, I really do like Lincoln a lot. It's just, Columbus is still so far my favorite city, but I'm not ruling Lincoln out. Like I said, dude, Julian Fleming.
You'll get there.
Like, hey, that's Nebraska's ranked second to Penn State in the Julian Fleming portal recruitment, but they're not out of it.
Love it.
Life, so
love it.
Still a chance.
Well, common fans, make sure to check out the Nebraska Rivals site, Inside Nebraska. Make sure to check out the Inside Nebraska podcast. Thanks so much to publisher and insider Zack Carpenter for joining the Common Fans today. Zack, this was awesome. All Common Fans, go out and celebrate. Take the rest of the day off. Take the rest of the week off. We got Dylan Raiola. All is well in Husker Nation. We're washing the 5-7 season. We're washing that taste out of our mouths. We're moving into a new year and a new era for Nebraska football. So, Zack, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks, Zack.
And thank really you, Zack. Appreciate it. That was awesome.
And Common Fans, we'll be back soon. GBR for life.